Hello, we're going to be talking about flowcharts in this video, one of our ways of representing algorithms and our most visual way. So they are visual because they consist of multiple symbols which represent different things within our algorithms. And you've got to learn what these symbols are and understand when to use each one. The first symbol to learn is the terminal symbol, which is a rounded rectangle. The word terminal we usually associate with ending something, and it's used here to end an algorithm, but also it is used to start an algorithm as well. So often we write the word start and end in this shape, but also we can write a subprogram name, which I'll show you later. Now, I talked in the last video about the input, process, and output sequence of programs. We can represent programs using the sequence, and even within a program, we can break it down further into multiple inputs, multiple processes, multiple outputs. And so we represent these using, well, parallelograms for both input and output. They have the same shape. You'll just write different things in them, whether you are inputting or outputting. And process is just a normal rectangle. A process covers most normal instructions whenever you're modifying some values or performing a calculation or something like that. That's a process. I talked in my last video about processing also including checking. Well, if I'm checking something, we now use a different symbol in a flowchart. We use a diamond shape to represent a decision, and we use decisions for both selection and iteration. And all of these shapes must be connected using arrows. They're not just lines, they are arrows, because it represents the flow of your algorithm. The flow is the order in which the instructions are being executed. It's really important the order is as you want it to be. That's why we put arrows to make it clear. And the last shape, which you may forget if you're not careful, is a subprogram shape. This is the same as a rectangle, but has two vertical lines sort of within it. So it looks a little bit odd, but that represents a subprogram. What this is saying is we are calling a subprogram which exists somewhere else. I'll show you this in action a little bit later. Let me now show you some flowcharts in action, because you could be asked to both interpret a flowchart, which should be quite easy, hopefully, but also you could be asked to write your own flowchart in paper two. So you must be able to know what the symbols are used for and understand where they should get put. So let's start simple with asking for two numbers, adding them together and outputting this result. So we always start with a start symbol and we always end with an end symbol. Don't forget this in a flowchart. Often that'll be one mark at least. We write the word start, we write the word end. Now in this example, we're starting with inputs. I'm asking for two numbers, so I'm going to have two inputs. The input is a parallelogram, and what you write inside the symbol, there's not a definitive way to do this. I would just say, try and keep it relatively code related, make it like pseudocode, if not Python code or ERL code, because people sometimes make it a little bit too relaxed. We might just say input, but we want to make it a little bit like code. I'm inputting num1, I'm inputting num2. If you just said input num, it's not quite clear what you mean. Well, I'm wanting two separate numbers here. I then need to add them together. Well, adding them together is a process. I'm processing these two inputs, putting them together. And again, I'm trying to make it look a bit like code. I know it's visual, but still, you've got to try and make it specific enough. This is basically a line of code here. Total is set to be num1 plus num2. You could potentially say add num1 to num2, but I prefer it to be a bit code-like. And finally, I need to output it. So I use an output symbol, which is the same as an input symbol, just make sure the word output is here and make sure it connects up to end as well. Here is the equivalent code, just for your comparison. Often code is a lot simpler and quicker to write, in my opinion, if you were given a choice. Okay, a marginally trickier example here where we are going to perform selection. So it would normally be an if statement in a program. I'm going to ask the user for their age and output if they are an adult or a child. So as always, I just have a start symbol and I'm asking for input here. So now we have to do a decision. I am checking something that is a decision. And decision should always be true or false situations or yes or no questions. Personally, I prefer to do it as a question. So is age greater than or equal to 18? It's still a little bit code related. I'm not going too Englishy here. It's a yes or no answer. So I've got only two arrows coming out of this, but us having two arrows makes it a decision because suddenly our flow is determined on this condition. This is representing selection in a programming language. Now, if the age is bigger than or equal to 18, you are an adult. Well, I'm going to output adult. I'm doing it as a string. Again, I'm making it like program code and I go straight to end at that point. If it's no, I output child and also go straight to end. So end can be reached via two paths in this algorithm. And just to flash up the code as well, here is the equivalent in ERL. just using an if statement with basic selection. Let's look at how we perform iteration in a flowchart. So here I'm counting down from 100 to 1 inclusive in steps of minus 1. So I want to go 100, 99, 98, 97, and so on, all the way down to 1, then I'll stop. Now this would be a for loop in a program, or it should be a for loop in a program. How do you represent this in a flowchart? Well, it's pretty similar. It's the same sort of symbols I've shown you so far. But I need to think about, how am I going to actually formalize this in a flowchart? Well, let's make it, again, quite program code related and set a variable to be 100. I'm using I because it's often what we would use in a for loop, but it could be any variable here. It's 100 at the start. I then output it. I'm outputting it straight away, so I get my first number. Well, what do I have to check for now? I need to check to see if I is equal to 1. Because if I is equal to 1, I need to end my program because I'm done. If I was 1, I need to finish because that's when I stop. However, obviously, initially, I is not going to be equal to 1. It's going to be equal to 100. So what do I do now? Well, I've got to make it count down, I've got to go and subtract 1 from I. Again, I'm writing it in process, not in English, because it can get a little bit too vague. I'm writing it as if it was code, and I'm subtracting 1 from this variable. But critically, you can see my arrow now is going back on itself. The arrow is going back into this earlier arrow, and we are putting it right before I'm outputting my value I. And this is how a loop is represented in a flowchart. If you've got arrows going back on itself, that is representing a loop, not just simple selection. I'm using the same symbol as selection, but I'm going back on itself. That's what makes it a loop. Here it is in ERL, and it's a good example of what I was saying earlier about if you are given a choice, always do it in code. In my opinion, it's just a lot simpler and shorter. Now, let's look at one final example where I'm just going to steal the one I've just used, but make it a little bit more complicated. I want to ask the user this time if they want to launch a countdown. If they say yes, countdown from 100 to 1 inclusive, like we just did, but this time making use of a subprogram called countdown. And then we want to repeat this until the user says no. Repeat this until is a very subtle thing to pick up on in exam questions. This means use a while loop. Repeat this until is looping based on a condition. I need to use a while loop here. So how do I represent a while loop in a flowchart? And also, I've got a subprogram to worry about here. Well, let's deal with our subprogram first. So I'm assuming you know what this is. I won't explain it because a future video will go into what a subprogram is if you're not quite sure. But long story short, it's a block of code which has a name. So this is how I'd represent a subprogram. I've, to save me effort, I've just stolen the same code as before, the same algorithm as before, where we are counting down from 100 to 1. However, the one difference is I have now changed the word start to be countdown, because here is my subprogram being defined. I am saying the subprogram is called countdown. This is its name, and this is the code which should run when I'm calling it. So in ERL, this would be a procedure because I'm not returning. I just put my for loop in the procedure. The procedure is called countdown. Now, that's one half of my flowchart. That's the definition of my subprogram. But I also want to do the remaining code, which is going to make use of this subprogram. So I start like normal. In this scenario, I'm asking the user if they want to launch a countdown. They input their answer, and I check to see, is their answer equal to yes? If the user says yes, we want to do this countdown. And because I've defined the subprogram called countdown, I need to call this countdown. And I call it using our weird looking flowchart symbol for a subprogram. So one with our vertical lines in. And we can imagine this jumping to this other flowchart and running that flowchart. Then when it finishes, it returns back here. And in this particular case, we want to loop back round right to the start, because we want to let the user keep repeating it until they say no. So because we're going to repeat it until they say no, if the answer is not equal to yes, we want to check if the answer is equal to no. If the answer is equal to no, we want to end our algorithm. If the answer was not equal to no, a little bit confusing, we want to probably also loop back to the start, because only no should end this algorithm. The code for this bit would look something like this, where I've got a while loop and also I've got an if statement inside it, but I'm calling my subprogram, which would run the code in the subprogram definition.